We've been in a series of messages from the book of Acts. We're looking at how the church formed and the Holy Spirit worked and how the early Christians grew together and some of the issues that they had. And today we come to Acts chapter 12, in which this is one of my favorite parts of the whole Bible because it is shockingly human. And we can learn an awful lot about prayer. So let me read this with us. Acts 12. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some of those belonging to the church intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. When he saw that this pleased the people, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the feast. The Feast of Unleavened Bread. So after arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod had intended to bring him out for public trial and execution after Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. And suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone on the cell. He struck Peter in the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said. And then the chains fell off Peter's wrists, and the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes, put on your sandals." And Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you, follow me," the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed the first and second guards, came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them, and they went through it. When they walked the length of one street, suddenly the angel left him, and Peter came to himself and said, "Well, now I know without a doubt the Lord sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything that the people were anticipating." When this dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying for him. Isn't that interesting? Peter knocked on the outer entrance, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening the door and exclaimed, "Peter's at the door." "You're out of your mind," they said. "You're crazy." She kept insisting it was so. And they said, "Oh, it must be his angel. He's already dead." But Peter kept on knocking. And when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. "Tell James and the brothers about this," he said, and then he left for another place. In the morning, there was no small commotion among the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. And after Herod had done a thorough search made for him and didn't find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they all be executed. Isn't that amazing? Passage of scripture. So Lord, teach us from this. Teach us how we might live, and teach us how to pray, and teach us how to celebrate when you do answer our prayers. Thank you for all that you do and all that you are and all that you want to do in and through us. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so I'm not hyper spiritual. You know, there's a lot of you who are more spiritual than me. I understand that. And some of you are spooky spiritual. You know, that scares me a little bit. But I just looked at this passage through my life and thought, why is this even in the Bible? Because it shows us how we are too often. Now, have you ever wanted to have like an angel intercede in your life? Have you ever wanted that? Have you ever thought about what it'd be like if, like, you know, God's messenger came and "Oh, Chris, you know, thou art a fine young man," you know, that sort of thing, you know? I've always wondered what it'd be like, but now after reading this passage today, I don't think I want that. You have Peter, who is about to be executed. He's obviously secured in prison. But an angel appears in the midst, and you'd think that the angel would say, "Hey, God loves you. This is an answer to the prayer for the whole community who's been praying for you over at John Mark's house. And we're going to get you out because, you know, the Lord wants to bless you and bless your ministry. And really, you're so important to the church, really. You know, you're the rock, you know. And you mean so much to everybody. You're so valuable. And so we want to make sure nothing bad happens to you. So is that what the angel said? No. See, this is what's disturbing. What does the angel say to him? He comes over to him. Peter's sleeping. The angel appears, and he kicks him in the side. What is with that? Kicks him. Get up! That is how God's messenger communicated with him. And, you know, obviously got his attention. What happened to that soft or spiritually resonant voice? You know, that, get up. And then the angel said to him, beloved of God, thou art, no, put on your clothes. And then, like talking to a kid, and put on your sandals. We're going outside. You're not going to go out barefoot. My golly. And then, this keeps closing on me. It's not my preaching. So the angel says, put on your coat. Now, this is a chance for the angel to really model how God wants to talk to him. And what is happening here? It's so real, right? Get up. Get dressed. Not just get your shoes on, but it's cold. Get your coat on. We're not coming back. And then he leads them out. And Peter probably was thinking he's having a nightmare because it'd be better to be executed by Herod than to, have to deal with this. And then he left in the street, an escapee of prison, supposed to be executed the next day. And he goes, I better get over to John Mark's house and let him know I'm okay. Right? Wouldn't you want to do that? Let's celebrate this with the brothers and sisters in the church, and we'll all have a hug fest and celebrate together. I think you can hardly wait to get there. Now, there's been a lot of talk and study, and we've shared about it a lot, and preaching and all those things on what prayer is. And I think that this passage teaches us that we've got to be careful about what we pray for. Because if something happens in prayer where we are trying to either convince God of what needs to happen and how God should do this, or we have to pray in such a way that we protect God's reputation so nobody thinks that, the Lord let us down, right? We spend a lot of time doing those two things. So here we have the church, faithfully praying, gathered. They know that Peter's, what's happening, and they know the serious of it, and James has just been executed, and Peter's next, and they're distraught, but they are focused in their prayer. And I can just imagine their prayers. Lord, we know he's going to die in the morning, but help him to be a good witness to a guard tonight. Help him to be able to have an opportunity maybe to share his faith just before he dies. Maybe that would make a little difference. Or Lord, give Peter courage. You know, this is a really hard thing, and help him not to back out of his faith publicly in front of everybody at the trial. Help him to stay firm. Don't let him do what he did the night that Jesus was on trial. Help him to learn from that, Lord, because Peter can be a little unstable, Lord, and he really needs to be strengthened here. So help him to be a strong witness right up to his death. And Lord, while you're at it, take care of us, two down. we don't want the third one. So Lord, you know, help us to find a new way to witness so that we're not offensive to others and nobody else gets arrested. That's bad for a reputation. Yeah, I mean, I can just imagine this prayer meeting. I used to go to these Wednesday night prayer meetings at this church when I was younger, and all these people would gather and they would pray about these things, and I would sit there going, is this a different language? I don't even know what they're talking about. And they're asking things so specifically. And then I learned that I do that too. I have an idea of what God ought to do or how things should work out, and I make sure that I clarify that with the Lord. That's what prayer is, right? We had we were a missions church in Walnut Creek, very proud of that. We gave $5 to 1,000 mission agencies, and thought that was a great thing. And so, but we had a group that prayed for 35 years. They met every Wednesday night and prayed for 35 years without failure for the people of Latin America, particularly in Brazil, and the problems there, the streets, and crime, and things like that. And he would pray for them. They prayed for missionaries. They would write to them and talk about how they're praying for them. And me and Tim Halls, our missions pastor, got an idea. Why don't we go down to Brazil and meet with all these different ministries that are working with street kids? There's thousands and thousands of street kids living on the streets. And let's see what they're doing, and maybe we can get involved, and maybe teams from our church could come down and work with them, and we could get to know them face-to-face and all those things. And he said, wouldn't it be great if the people in the South American prayer group could come with us and see face-to-face what it is that they've been praying for 35 years? Wouldn't that be great? I said, well, that's expensive. Tim said, we're going to raise the money. They'll all come as our guest. Free. To see face to face what it is that they've been praying for and how God's answering their prayers. So we made that offer. Do you know how many of them came on the trip with us?
40.
Zero. Not one. Not one. Why indeed? Why? I was surprised. I thought 40 would be a good round number. You know, at least 35 for each year that they pray. I asked one of the people, why don't you want to do this? Well, you know, it's really important that we meet on Wednesday night and pray, and if I'm down there with you, I'm not going to be able to be at the prayer meeting. Somebody else said, why would we go down there? You know. Why would we go there? It's not like home. Why would we spend money on that? Wouldn't it be better to send the money instead of going personally? You know, anyway, all these, whatever the excuses were. But zero people after 35 years of prayer didn't want to meet face to face with the people and meet the kids and hear the stories and, you know, and build connections. And I thought, wait a minute. What if the people are the answer to our prayers? What if the people that we're praying for are actually the answers to our prayers? What was the name of the person you...
Luke?
Luke. When we prayed for Luke today out here. What if Luke is going to be the answer to our prayers? That changes everything. See, the people in the early church here in Acts were gathered, they were faithful, they were praying just so sincerely. So sincerely. And they were bugged because while they're praying, while they're bringing their request to the Lord, they're all one heart and one mind in prayer for Peter, this knocking on the gate is interrupting them. Don't you hate it when you're wanting to do ministry and you're interrupted by people? Has that ever happened? Lord, I'm trying to do my devotions here. Will you stop having people call me? At least, you know, maybe I should take the phone off the hook so nobody can interrupt me while I'm praying for them. So Peter's out there knocking, which is a dangerous thing to do in the middle of the night because that draws attention to yourself, right? But he's out there, he's knocking. And they finally tell Rhoda, the housemaid, go tell him to shut up because we're praying. We're doing something important here. So she goes out there. Peter says, hey, it's me, let me in, come on, let me in. And she leaves him outside. Now, how often do we do that? We get the answer to our prayers, and we go out, and we're so consternated that God has answered in a way that we didn't expect, that we turn and go back in. Wow, you're not going to believe this. Peter's outside the gate right now. He's out on the street right now. And of course, I love their response. You're nuts! That's got to be in the Bible. You know, right there. That's why you know the Bible's real. You are crazy. Talking about, we're praying for him that he'll have strength in his time of need. You know, we're praying for him that he'll be a strong witness at his death. What do you mean he's outside? That's crazy.
It was also sexist. Well, you don't send a woman to do a man's job or something like that. I don't know.
But anyway, so she goes back, brings them all there. He's outside, sure enough. They all stand around. No one invites him in. No one celebrates with him. No one said, hey, Peter, it's kind of dangerous out here on the street. You could be seen and heard, and you're pounding on the walls. We're really sorry. Come on in. Let's have a time of Thanksgiving. No, they just kind of stood and looked at him. Huh? Not you. You. Who would have thought? And finally, it was Peter who said, can we go inside? This is getting weird. I don't know if he said this is getting weird, but the implication is that. So finally he says, come on, you can just bring me in. And that reminded me of the church. You know, how often have we prayed for people to come be a part of our congregation and when we come, well, I don't know, you know, it's probably better that they wait in the car. I don't know if they're going to fit in here, and then we're not celebrating when they're the very answer to our prayers. There's no evidence of any praise in this, or thanksgiving, or celebration. Robert Louis Stevenson said, I'll learn more about your prayers from listening to your praise than listening to your prayers. Mm-hmm. Which is an interesting insight because the scripture says that God inhabits the praises of his people. Right? That means God comes alive in our praises. God comes to life as we praise. And there wasn't any praising going on. There wasn't thanksgiving because they weren't expecting this as the answer. They didn't expect Peter to get out of the prison and come to the house and continue on. They were praying that he would be a good witness in this time of death and that God would bring comfort to him and to his wife, his widow. Now that this is all over, and they're probably praying for their own safety. But now, Peter's presence outside the gate creates all kinds of issues. Now he's a wanted man. Herod is going to be really upset. This may mean more persecution for the church. And if anybody sees that he came to this house is not a safe place anymore. That means we're not safe. That means we're the next ones to go. Why did Peter come here? Why couldn't he have gone somewhere else and let us know that he's okay? You know, I think that we could learn from this about prayer and about how to celebrate one another. If you ever gone somewhere and you show up and they go, "Oh, it's you." you know, I know I'm a disappointment. I thought you wanted somebody good here. You know, "Oh, it's you." Have you had that feeling ever? It's like you think, "Oh, this is going to be great." And then you go, "They're not excited that it's me." And I think that's a little bit of how Peter felt. I wonder if that's how God feels when he proactive, because see, prayer is not to get God to do something, to convince him. Prayer is for us to realize, to be thankful for what he's already done, he's been doing, and what he's doing right now. And when we're aware of that, it changes our whole outlook of expectation. I get that from our dogs. They're not our dogs. One's Damien's and one's Eileen's. But you get the point. When they come out of boarding, we went on vacation, you know, and came back, and the dogs came home, and they were so up, and then I walked in, and they just had that look of, "Oh, that's too bad. It's him." And I thought of the church, you know? How can we not celebrate the people who are the answer to our prayers because God brought them to us for whatever reason, whatever purpose? So how do we pray? That's an important issue. How do we pray? How do we not become like that early church in Acts 12? Well, I was reading about this and had the idea that, you know how Jesus is interceding for us, that word intercessor, that in the New Testament describes Jesus as praying on our behalf, right? He prays on our behalf. That actually, if you picture, when you're praying, that actually Jesus is not just the recipient of your prayer, but Jesus is praying for you, right? So you may not have the words, you may not know what to pray, you may be confused or consternated or whatever, and consternated, not the other one. And I said it correctly.
You people.
And Jesus is actually intervening and praying on your behalf. Now, there's people in your life. We have put names in here last week. But there's other people in your families. And honestly, we don't know how to pray for them. We don't know what to pray for. Usually, when I want to pray for someone, it's because they've irritated me to the point where they've risen up in my consciousness, and now, Lord, here's what could be done to fix them, you know? And I usually have a few things that could be done. Sometimes my prayer is, you know, honestly, Lord, change them or take them home. You know, just telling you, you know, I'm not saying that's a role model. But what if we allowed ourselves to picture Jesus praying for them, and we're listening in? What would Jesus pray for them? Jesus, who made them, who loves them, who calls them by name, who knows their struggles, knows their secrets, knows their issues, knows their giftedness, knows their relationship. How would Jesus pray for them? If we could eavesdrop on that prayer, it would be transformational, wouldn't it? We would start to go, "Oh, yeah, you know, I forgot. Yeah, you know, there's so much to that person. I was just concerned about a little part of them. But there's a lot to them, Lord, and you've shown that. And you love them for all these reasons. And you haven't given up on them for all these reasons. Why should I? Why should I give up on them if you haven't? And we actually give ourselves space to listen to how Jesus prays for them. Then, let's take it one step further. Listen to see how Jesus prays for you. He knows you. He made you. He calls you by name. He loves you. He knows your secrets. He knows your issues. He knows all the things going on. He knows that, and he loves you regardless. And how would Jesus pray for you? What would he be celebrating in you? What would he be so thrilled to bring to the surface about you? Maybe it's things in you that you haven't even thought about for a long time. Maybe it's things you've dismissed. You don't know. But what would he say about you? I think it's time we allow Jesus to be the intercessor. And there's nothing wrong with eavesdropping on him. He wants you to know how he feels about you. He wants you to know that your life has meaning and value and purpose and all of those things. Things happen in our life, you know. Sometimes we don't even know why, but it happens. It affects our relationships. It affects everything. Prayer is about relationships, I'll tell you that. Prayer can be a barrier that we put up, or it can be an open door. Is it okay to share something personal?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. People involved are not going to see this video. in my family, every time we go to San Diego, there's a family connections. And so Saturday, I went out to the Westfall Winery with my brother. This is the brother for 20, 25 years, we never spoke to each other. Ever. I'd go up to them at a family get together and say hi, and they'd turn and walk away. Never a word. And I never really knew why, but I thought, well, okay. All right, let it go. And don't try. And so we had zero relationship. And then one day, when I was 50, he'd heard that I was making wine in Napa. And so he asked if he could come up from San Diego and pick grapes with me and learn how to do it. So I said, okay. You're going to be coming to our house. Okay. So he did. And we picked grapes together. And I realized that was the first time in 50 years that we had ever done anything together. We spent a day together. First time in 50 years. So Saturday, we're in our tradition, we went out and picked grapes at the winery, and we did the crush. It'll be Zinfandel, and you'll be seeing it later on your store shelves. But Damien once asked him, why did you never speak to my dad all those years? He said, well, I don't really remember. I think it was because he was a Christian, and we were just so worried that he was going to try and convert us. So we thought we better not even say hello. Better to have no relationship than to have him try and convert us. And Damien said, oh, well, you didn't know my dad. He would never try and convert you. He'd probably try and talk you out of it. And I thought, isn't that funny? A wall was set up based on what thoughts or expectations or fears or whatever had nothing to do with reality. And decades went by with no relationship. And I'm thinking, all the times that I prayed for him and his family and how God could fix them. I wasted years and years praying that God would fix them, have them quit being the way they are and have them be more what I think they ought to be and blah, blah, blah. And all the while God said, the answer to your prayer is there. Go celebrate. I thought, I don't want to miss any more of this. I want to celebrate with you. I want to be glad every time I see you. Say, wow, it's a miracle. You're here. I'm here. That's a real miracle. God brought us together for a reason. And we're so grateful for each other. And we start calling out the things in each other that we appreciate and are praiseworthy and things that the person may have forgotten were even part of them. And we say, thanks for seeing that. I think it would transform us in a radical way. So that's the lesson today from Acts 12. Don't leave each other standing out at the gate while you pray for them. Let God show you what he's done, what he's doing right now, and what he can do. And let's teach people how to pray by sharing our praises. So pray with me. Lord Jesus, we do praise you, and we thank you, and we love you. And at the same time, we get all messed up like the early church did. But thank you for your care that you don't leave us, and you don't forget us, and you don't just walk away. So Lord, teach us to pray. Help us to hear you interceding for us and with us. We'll give you glory, we'll give you the praise, and most of all, Lord, we'll give you our life. In Jesus' name, amen.